To start this job, you want to make sure you take your battery loose on your mower. You'll be taking your shroud off of it, including its fan guard, which this is the fan guard. And you want to make sure everything is clean. You want to cover this up, blow it out real good with air to make sure you don't have any kind of debris that's going to end up in your carburetor. Put you a clamp on your fuel line, okay? Now let's go to the rest of it, showing you how to use a kit to rebuild the typical problem of surging and not running right of a Briggs Stratton V-twin intake motor. All right, come on. This is not a metric motor. So these are 5/16 head screws, although I'm sure you can use metric tools on it. And remove this first, your cover second. There is a screw right here in the top of this air filter housing that has to come out. It is just a little small quarter drive or flathead screw. You'll take out all your screws that hold it here all the way around, and you'll find that there's some of them back here in the back. You'll have to use a regular wrench to get to, likely. And at this time, you should order your spark plugs, get your fuel pump and new air filter, which is what I've done here. Got this, got all my plugs, and do a complete service on it while you're at it. The second thing is get you a couple of cans of good brake clean, because it works excellent on aluminum. And this was very dirty up in here and caused it to run warm inside the cooling right here, where the fan actually blows the air across the cylinders. And so I saturated it down with it all plugged off and with a towel over the top of this, and then took air and blasted it out. And it, now it's quite a bit cleaner than it was, so it should run a lot cooler. As far as changing your fuel pump, there's usually a lot of debris of backflow from this line when you take it loose, and it will jam up your fuel pump, my experience. So I would replace that fuel pump right there, right there. All you need is a pair of small vice grips like these needle nose, pinch the fuel line, and then these are 3/8 inch, and everything just pretty simple, self-explanatory on the fuel pump. You'll have to give it a second to prime when you start to fire this back up, so don't panic. It might take a minute to start. I've even run a battery down on one of these trying to fire it up after the fact. It is a 22 horse intake motor. This is model number 441777. Many of these are going to be alike because they use the same style carburetor. This is the same style manifold and carburetor that you're going to find on most of the V-twins in the intake family, from, I don't know, 18 or 20 horse on up to about 25. And as you can see, I've plugged off my intakes on both sides with a few rags so I could use air to blow this out and clean it. And then I just used a quarter inch extension to put into the fuel line, because it'll continue to drip as long as your tank is higher than this, and stuff the other end, which is the driver end, into your PCV line that runs back up, positive crankcase ventilation line that runs back up to your carburetor. And these are T30 Torx, okay, and 3/8 nut T30 Torx. So that's what you got right there. There's four of them. They do have some lock on them, so you want to put some Loctite back on them when they go back in. When you pull this loose, you want to seal that up. Now, these come with a reusable seal on them. I suggest cleaning them very well, putting them back on and torquing them down to about, I think it's about 30 inch pounds, 20 inch pounds, somewhere in that neighborhood. Check your manuals on it, you'll know. Me, I just torque it down enough to where I feel like I'm going to break it, and I stop. Now, what I've got here is I've got the carburetor turned upside down. And here is normally the cause of your ailments in these engines when they start acting up and surging and going crazy. It's this O-ring right here. There's two jets in there, and there's a left and a right. And if you'll look on your carburetor, you will see on the other side an L and an R, in case you're wondering. But the safest way to do this, because these are two different size stage jets, is to make sure that you take one at a time. Now, you can order a kit from eBay, and I'm going to put the guy's link in here. It comes with a body ring, which is this, As you can see, mine's pretty wore out. That seats down into this spot right here, okay, next to the float. And it comes with the two little bitty O-rings that go to the jets and the one big O-ring which replaces this one. And look at that. Look at the difference here. This is that O-ring. That's years of gasoline going through it. As you can see, they just went to hell. Look how big that thing is. It was mashed all up in there. That's the one that belongs in there. So I'll get you this guy's information right here. You're gonna be looking for this on eBay. He free ships, he gets them to you quick, and pretty crafty guy. All right. And you're going to remove your fuel bowl, which has the shutoff on it. So that activates, pulls the plunger down, allows the fuel to flow. So whenever you're not powered, it springs back up and shuts the fuel off. And it pushes this little plunger right here. However, if this plunger is allowing fuel to get sucked in around it, instead of going through it like it's supposed to, you know, through the hole there, there's where your problems are, and she'll surge and surge and hunt like she can't find her RPMs, and that's your issue. All right, back to the carburetor. Now, what we've got to do is you've got to use some very fine tools, very fine point tools, to get and work on these jets. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull the jets out one at a time, and you'll see, look at this, they just slop around in there. That O-ring is supposed to hold these in there. And that jet is loose. This one's still tight. This side is very loose. All right, now very, very carefully, you're going to take a needle or a very sharp little probe tool like one of these, and you're going to carefully lift one at a time out. Do not remove both, because you're going to put one back at a time. Being that these jets are literally a 30th of a millimeter difference, it's very hard to tell with the eye, even though if you was to get a microscope, you can probably see some numbers on it. I don't know if you can see them with this camera, but there are numbers on them, and it's very hard to see, but you can see that O-ring is quite flat. We're going to replace that, pull the other one out after installing this one back and replace that, and then backwards procedure on replacing the O-rings. It's not a hard thing to do. You're just going to flip this carburetor upside down. Everything's right in front of you. Do like I do. Put you a nice large rag or t-shirt or something down here underneath to where your parts can go and you're not going to lose them. And especially this kind of stuff, very hard to get. Each one of these is about $15. You lose it. Don't lose it. All right. Now I've got the second one. Let's see. Hold it up here so you can see it. I've got the second one completely done. This one here is now installed. There's the two. Let's see if I can get in there without the shadow here. There's the second one. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that and I'm going to put it on the end of my tool, as you see here, just like that. And I'm going to get this where I can hold it. With it like that, very carefully, I'm going to reach up and just hold it with the edge of my finger and go back in over here. Hope that shadow is not getting the best of you. And I'm going to drop it in place and then give it a little bit of a walk in to where it pops into place. There. Now, they're no longer loose and they're no longer flopping around, allowing fuel to shoot past them. So now the governor and everything will work just fine on this engine. We're going to take this O-ring and install it next. We're going to get this now, the O-ring for it, fit into place. And that's pretty self-explanatory. And you'll see it carefully remove as you take yours apart. Look at it carefully. Like mine, yours will probably be still stuck in your fuel bowl. Okay, it'll probably still be stuck down there, laying in there like mine was. And get your new O-ring on it, put it together, clean your surfaces very well, get your surfaces real good and clean. Do not use carburetor cleaner. I would suggest using a Q-tip and just wiping it out with a little bit of WD-40 or something, but I wouldn't use carburetor cleaner because it'll affect your new O-rings. Don't get it in them and go from there. All right, now the easy way to reinstall this in reverse is, remember, you have your wires for your fuel shutoff. This is a fuel shutoff solenoid plug, and you have your wires for that. Some of yours might differ. They might be a different angle for that solenoid, but pretty much the same thing is the reverse of it, the reverse of removal. So what I've done is I've installed that inside. You can see the O-ring around it, and that O-ring is going to sit on this surface. It doesn't go inside it. It sits on the surface, okay? That is to keep you from having flooding from your fuel bowl being full. And that's its purpose. Whenever it's flooding, that's when it starts doing this crazy bouncing and surging. As far as the needles and needle seats in these, they last a very long time. Before you do your O-rings, if you want to spray it out with carburetor cleaner, do it, but use some air behind it to make sure you dry it quickly so it doesn't affect your O-rings. And one of the quick things to do is if you want to keep your O-rings, you can basically hit it with a little WD-40 afterwards and then blow air on it again, and that will preserve your O-rings. It'll erase the carburetor cleaner effect on it and neutralize it. So a little WD-40 goes a long ways on cleaning these off after you've gotten your varnish and all the other things cleaned off of your carburetor. So let's roll with it. That's how it goes back, right on top. Now a quick little suggestion before you put all this back together, other than putting some rags in your intakes, lean it forward, hook your governor on. Your governor arm is right here. This is your governor arm right here. And you're going to hook onto it. Do not remove it from this side of the carburetor. You will hate yourself for doing that. So as you can see, this hook is made. So when this is rotated, it's gonna hook, and then you will be able to line it up. There's no bolt studs on these, so it's easy to just come straight in and line up. All right, guys, make sure you clean these real good. You see, I have a few small dings in my gasket right here. For some of you that might have that, get you a standard black RTV, like Pro Seal here, and you're gonna put a very, very thin film of it on here, very thin film. Do not allow it to get inside here or even in this groove here. Wipe this outwards as you put it on and then quickly install it on there. Do not torque it fully. Give it about an hour and then you can torque it to its whatever the specs are on it. All right, so I've got to finish cleaning these surfaces, and you can use a standard razor blade to do that to clean the old stuff off of there. As you can see, it's coming off. Once you've done that, you're ready to go. The typical restore that you're gonna do on a Briggs & Stratton Intech motor. A lot of them use this same carburetor setup. The kits can be different for them. However, this is 99% of the time your problem. And I'm sure this is my problem because I fix these plenty of times. And just be sure you don't forget your governor, because if you do, she certainly won't run right. All right, guys, do it yourself, save you money. Right from surging to solid. Sounds smooth. It was hunting like crazy. Wouldn't run right. Now, there she is. Not bad. Grand total of pricing for the air filter, the O-ring set, spark plugs, and everything all ran under about $45. Not a bad deal. Make yours run yourself. You can do it.